Next up is Martin Kreitmair from Tangany, and he will tell us a little bit about innovation killers and how to resolve these issues.
Yeah, hi everyone. Hi, thank you for having me today. My name is Martin Kreitmair. I'm one of the co-founders and managing directors at Tangany, and I would like to speak a little bit about network fees on the blockchains and why we consider them to be an innovation killer, and what solutions we are seeing at Tangany to overcome those high levels of fees we are facing today. So yeah, let me start with the mandatory two slide promotion. Tangany is a crypto custodian based in Munich, Germany. We are around for 4 years now and regulated under the preliminary crypto custody license with BaFin, having more than 30 clients from across Europe, mainly in Germany, and doing everything from cold and warm wallet storage, where we have 60,000 wallets currently under management, and our clients are trusting us with more than 350 million euros under custody, from cryptocurrencies, stablecoins, to security tokens, also NFT and everything else you can tokenize on the blockchain. And a quick look on what kind of clients we are serving. So basically everything from the traditional finance world, from SME banks, digital banks, neobanks, asset managers, to tokenization providers, but the issuer itself looking for a custody solution. And also use cases from the crypto market, which we call crypto native applications. So when it comes to crypto payment solutions, staking, saving, lending, and of course also trading, that can be perfectly done with our solution, which is an API white label custody solution combined with infrastructure and regulatory services. So the fees. What's the issue with the fees on the blockchain? Let us take a look on the general issues here. So there are three things to keep in mind. The first thing is networks like Ethereum or Bitcoin, they are limited in terms of transactions per second. Ethereum is currently only able to execute about roughly 30 transactions per second. It's not much more on Bitcoin. And if you combine that limitation, which is really a low number, mostly if you like, compare it to credit card providers such as Visa or MasterCard, which are able to process more like 1,000 or 10,000 more transactions per second. If you take that into consideration and look at how our transactions are executed on the blockchain, which is built on some kind of auction model. Yeah, the more you bid, the higher is the probability that your transaction will be included into the next transaction. And that, of course, is a very highly probability here, that if transactions are limited and you have to bid for your transaction, that the bids will increase the more transactions are on the network. And lastly, the miners are the one who select which transaction is executed or included within the next block. So they receive the fee from the transactions, and they, of course, choose the transactions with the highest fees. So that are three conditions which don't work perfectly together, especially when transactions are going or increasing, which we are seeing currently with the latest bull cycle. And that can be reflected in some kind of loop, which we see regularly, like every 4 years. So it starts with the hype phase. The adoption is increasing. People are using blockchain. New products are evolving, like DeFi currently, or NFT products. And with that, the number of transactions are skyrocketing. which is generally a good thing because we aim for a larger adoption on the market and transactions should be increasing. But that's the bottleneck here. With the more transactions we are seeing, the higher the fees are getting due to the auction system that is being used on blockchain. So we have a bottleneck here and transactions are not executed anymore. They're getting backlogged. And it can take several minutes or even hours before a transaction gets processed. So the bottleneck leads to the overload. Transactions stuck and the usage of the blockchain gets very expensive, mostly Bitcoin and Ethereum currently, which are the major players here. And the usage gets, in an economical sense, not usable anymore. So the overload can only result in one final stage, and that's the reset. So the hype transforms into depression, and the usage is decreasing again. Everything will, getting a lower in number of fee amount that is to be paid for a transaction. And the adoption itself kills itself. What we call the success of blockchain kills itself due to a lack of scalability. So that's an issue that is inherit to blockchain since it started from 10 years ago with the evolution of Bitcoin and followed on with other blockchains. And with the current hype cycle, we are facing the same issues, but there are the first solutions to that. So, but let me first take a look on Bitcoin and the fees. So here we see a graph from the last 5 years and the average transaction fee for one transaction on the Bitcoin network. And we see mostly two sparks here, one 4 years ago, which was the crypto hype, when the wider population or citizens went into crypto and got the first touch point with crypto. And we see the current hype, the DeFi hype, and with that correlated the sparks in the network fees. We see two sparks in particular here. 4 years ago, that was nearly on Christmas 2017. That was when Bitcoin crashed with more than 37% within a matter of hours, and the fees skyrocketed from €3 to €60. That was only due to the sell pressure on the market. So every time we see kind of panic in the market, the fees skyrocket because everybody or many people wants to go out of crypto, wants to save their gains, and that leads to very high fees. The same with this bull cycle just a month ago when Bitcoin crashed another one third and the fee increased from already a very high value or level from €20 to €60. So that is not a level of fee that is affordable for most business cases. And that's a very huge innovation killer for the adoption of Bitcoin and Ethereum. For a comparison, here's the $5 line, which we consider to be the maximum for projects to be affordable and to make sense for the business case. And the $5 line has been left like half a year ago. And since then, we are way higher, like €20 or dollars per transaction. Quite the same on Ethereum. We see the hype 4 years ago. It's a little bit smaller compared to the current one. It's the ICO hype. We have the DeFi hype now. And the same 4 years ago, there's one spark. It was not sell pressure. It was the first game or the first application with wider adoption in the crypto space. It was CryptoKitties. When the fee increased from 30 cent to more than €3, so 10 times more only based on one application on the blockchain. And the same here a few days ago, when Ethereum crashed just like all the other cryptocurrencies with more than 40% in 10 hours and the fees increased from also €20 or €18 to more than €70 due to the sell pressure on the market. So there's a lot of going on, and every time crypto adoption is increasing, and with that the transactions are increasing, we limit ourselves because the capacity is just not yet there on the blockchain. So for that, we need solutions. Here's the $5 line, also left since Christmas last year. So there are a few solutions here. We segmented at Tangany in first level, second level, and new services. And let's now take a look at what solutions are there and which are suitable for which use case to reduce general network fees. So on the first level, there are built-in functionalities like Ethereum bulk transactions, where you take one or several transactions within one. You can add like 1,000, I believe, transactions within one bulk transaction, and that reduces the fee per transaction with like 40%. That is quite easily doable and usable. We see it frequently used at Tangany, but also in other use cases. The same goes for Bitcoin, where we have the functionality of multiple recipients. It's the base, the same concept like on bulk transactions on Ethereum, reduction of 30% in fees. So those two are already available and can be used, but they are only bringing a slight relief when it comes to network fees. On the first level, there is not too much else. Ethereum is aiming for sharding. In our point of view, that will not see a launch before 2022 or even 23. So we have to face the current limitations a few years more. But when it comes, the fees will be reduced to with more than 90%. So that's really a solution once it's here. Until then, we have to look into second layer solutions. There's the Bitcoin Lightning Network. The fees are reduced like more than 99%. But also the Lightning Network is like in beta phase, so it's more like an experimental solution, and it still needs to prove itself reliable. On Ethereum, we got Polygon, which is a third-party solution, bringing also a very huge reduction in fees, but it's not powered by Ethereum itself. It's another service, and of course, with that, another entity that you have to trust if you use Polygon. But we see a lot of requests for Polygon when it comes to Ethereum, but it will take another more detailed look in a few minutes. And on the new service part, there's the Binance Smart Chain, which is basically a fork of Ethereum. Comes with a lot of advantages with that and compatibility, but you have also to trust Binance here, which is which kind of holds the hand on the chain. But if used, the fees are reduced by more than 98%. And we have solutions like RAP tokens, like RAP Bitcoin, which can be issued on Ethereum or on the Binance Smart Chain. The same for RAP tokens or RAP Ethereums or Ethers on the Binance Smart Chain. And with that, the fee reduction because of the other blockchain that is being used in that kind. So let's take a look at a few of those options in more detail, how they are working and what are the pros and the cons, starting with the RAP Bitcoin. So RAP Bitcoin can be issued on both Binance Smart Chain, but also on Ethereum. But if you use Ethereum, then you face the same issues with the network fees. So in that case, looking in the Binance Smart Chain solution. And it has a lot of pros because it's very simple. It's based on BIP20. It's identically to ERC20 tokens. It's compatible with Ethereum Virtual Machine, which means you can use the same smart contracts you're using on Ethereum can be used on the Binance Smart Chain without any modifications. It's highly transparent. So all the assets that are incorporated into a token can be locked, that Binance is really holding the related amount of Bitcoin in the staked or in the deposited wallet on the Bitcoin chain. And there's an integrated bridge from Binance Smart Chain to Bitcoin to Ethereum to easily migrate from one to the other chain. And currently more than 5 billion euros are wrapped in Bitcoins at Binance. On the con side, we have, of course, the issue with the centralization. The Binance Smart Chain is kind of centralized. So you have to trust Binance, and the Binance Smart Chain itself is not widely supported, mostly when it comes to other exchanges, because they are often not too interested into supporting the Binance solution. And the bridge itself can only be used with a Binance account. So someone is really tying itself very closely to Binance, has a lot of pros, a few cons, but generally it's a good way to really reduce the fees, mostly if you're frequently working with Bitcoins and have a lot of transactions to do. Another solution of the Polygon network, which is focused on Ethereum. It's a second layer solution, which aims to reduce the fees with more than 99%. It's also compatible to Ethereum virtual machine. With that, you can use your smart contract on Ethereum and redeploy it on Polygon quite easily. So migration is quite easily doable. You have the bridge from Polygon to Ethereum, and lately they have added a bridge to Binance Smart Chain, so it's easily possible to move Ethereum or either from Ethereum to Polygon and vice versa. And what we see at Tangany, it's the industry favorite second layer solution. There are a few other alternatives out there, but Polygon has made it its way, and it's the one that has been chosen, and the migration is quite easily doable. On the con side, you have to trust Polygon. It's a third party independently from Ethereum. With that, a new architecture, a new layer of trust you have to bring in. And if you want to use the bridge, then you have to deploy your tokens on both Polygon and Ethereum. And with that, you have to pay the deployment cost on Ethereum, which can be an issue for a few use cases. But generally, that's a very, very good way to use or to stay close to Ethereum, but to reduce the network fees. Another solution is the Binance Smart Chain, which is an alternative to its Ethereum itself. It uses proof of stake authority. It has a huge ecosystem which is powered by Binance. So a lot of services and products that can be used. It even has surpassed Ethereum when it comes to daily transaction volume. And the world's largest DEX, PancakeSwap, is based on Ethereum, which is bigger or larger than Uniswap or Compound or other services on Ethereum. That's really impressive if you consider that that issue, that blockchain was only issued like 1 year ago. And again, the migration is quite easily doable because it's very close to Ethereum. On the con side, you have to trust Binance, and it's kind of centralized. It's only it only has 21 active validator nodes, which is similar to EOS as far as I know. So it's limited to 21. It's not comparable to Ethereum with thousands of node operators. But the validator nodes itself are kind of independent. Anybody can apply for a validator node. So there is some kind of decentralization built in, but it's not comparable to Ethereum.
Martin, we must wrap up.
So there are the most requested alternatives we are seeing at Tangany when it comes to network fees, to how to save fees for Bitcoin, but also for tokenization use cases, for uses on Ethereum, DeFi staking, that can be done on Binance Smart Chain. Tokenization is mostly done on Polygon. So that is what we are seeing, and that's the current state. So it's quite good to have a few alternatives, but it's still just workarounds, and it's not like where we want to heading to. And
Martin,
there's also an off-chain settlement solution. Yeah, give me one minute, Robert, please. I see the time.
One sentence or one slide or something?
Yeah, it's a second last slide. So there's an off-chain solution if you want to do it completely on your own, run your own blockchain solution without any network fees at all. That is a preferred solution. If you have a lot of internal transactions from one customer to another, then you can do it off-chain without any fees at all. So that are the major solutions we are seeing. And to the conclusion, scalability is still a huge issue on blockchain. Luckily, we have a few alternatives already, if you compare it to 2017 or even before 2013, to mitigate the costs. And what we see, all alternatives try to stick as close as possible to the Ethereum virtual machine to be compatible with Ethereum, to have the option to migrate back to Ethereum once scalability is solved, which might be in 2 years. And for the time until then, all the alternatives we are seeing and where we see requests.
Thank you very much, Martin. I'll have to interrupt you now. We have to move on. Thank you again, Martin Kreitmair from Tangany. Sadly, we don't have time for the questions which came up.